President Bush says the attack shows Saddam Hussein is trying to change the course of the war, but he will fail to do so. Another Iraqi Scud missile aimed at Allied forces in Saudi Arabia was shot down. The US Air Force video shows the accuracy of precision bombing of carefully chosen targets in Iraq. It is still not clear tonight whether Israel intends to retaliate against Iraq for last night's Scud missile attack. The United States spent much of the day trying to persuade the Israeli government not to enter the Gulf War, pointing out the implications for maintaining Arab unity within the Allied alliance and Allied Air Force successes today in destroying some of the mobile Scud missile launchers. But the Israeli cabinet appears to be split, with the defense minister saying in a television interview, "We will react, certainly." The seven Scud missiles that hit Israel last night slightly injured 12 people. President Bush said earlier this evening the attack was an act of terror with no military significance, adding how much he appreciated Israel's restraint. The Allied air attack on Baghdad has been renewed. The Americans say the Allies are flying 2,000 air sorties a day, and more than 80% of them have been successful. A second British Tornado has been lost, one of seven Allied aircraft lost since the war began. The Americans say Allied ships have sunk three Iraqi patrol boats in the Gulf. The Defense Secretary, Tom King, has announced that the 1st Battalion of the Coldstream Guards is to fly to the Gulf to establish prisoner of war camps. And Royal Auxiliary Air Force Squadron 4624 is being called up to help transport personnel and supplies to the Gulf. The military strategy of the Allies does not appear to have changed from the pattern established on day one of Desert Storm. But the launching by Iraq of the Scud attack on Israel represented a clear change in Iraq's response. Of the seven Scud missiles known to have been fired against Israel last night from mobile launchers in western Iraq, two fell on Tel Aviv and two on the northern port of Haifa. In Saudi Arabia, a Scud missile fired against the Allies' airbase at Dhahran was brought down by an air defense missile. And the Pentagon says 11 mobile Scud launchers have been tracked down and at least six of them destroyed. More Tomahawk cruise missiles have been fired from two American warships in the Gulf at targets in Iraq, including Baghdad. Giant B-52s have bombed Iraqi ground forces, though the scale of the attack is not known. And the BBC's John Simpson in Baghdad reports B-52s causing great damage around the capital. Airfields and air defense systems continue to be attacked by British and Saudi Arabian tornadoes, now joined by a squadron of Italian tornadoes. The Defense Secretary, Tom King, said significant damage had been done to Iraqi nuclear, biological and chemical installations. After the Scud missile attack in the early hours of this morning, there was another air raid alert in Israel this evening after fears that the country was under attack for the second night running. Israeli radio reported there had been a rocket attack, but an army spokesman said the alert was a false alarm.
We were passing the walls of the old city of Jerusalem when the air raid siren was sounded. Immediately, Israel radio instructed everyone to get to their homes and stay in sealed rooms in case of chemical attack. Tonight is the eve of Shabbat, the Jewish holy day, and families were sitting down to their evening meal as the alert came. Everyone was later to hear with relief that it had been a false alarm. This was the remains of a house in Tel Aviv after this morning's missile attacks. Miraculously, only seven people were hurt. Although the military were wearing full protective clothing, these were conventional warheads. Eight missiles landed altogether in the Haifa and Tel Aviv central area. There was no warning of them. Inside the house, rooms were wrecked. The relief here is that it was not a chemical attack and that no one was killed. A woman who was in the house at the time described what had happened.
The glass exploded. All of us didn't know what to do. My father, I called an ambulance for him, which took him to the hospital. My mother fainted. Everything's amiss.
This was the reaction of one Jerusalem family when the air raid siren went off at 2 a.m. The father is a TV cameraman, and he captured the panic felt here as expectations grew that there was about to be a chemical attack. In Tel Aviv, hospitals had been well prepared. The injured from the Scud attacks were treated quickly. Several of the victims had panicked and injected themselves with atropine, fearing that they had inhaled gas. This was what remained of one of the missiles which landed on residential apartments in Tel Aviv's northern suburbs. A family of four, including two young girls, were asleep at the time. Like several of the other missiles, the warhead did not explode properly. Soldiers weren't taking any chances as they continued their search this morning for missiles which may not have exploded. At daybreak, some locals still weren't convinced that they were out of danger. Then later today to the issue of retaliation and whether or not Israel's air force would strike against Iraq. At a meeting at the Ministry of Defense in Tel Aviv, Prime Minister Shamir decided to hold off and await further developments, accepting American assurances that they would seek to destroy all Iraq's mobile launchers. But ministerial moods and opinions were mixed.
The American government is well aware that if we are attacked, we will retaliate, and we were attacked.
We are facing now the blitz on Israel's cities, and it may very well there may very well be another attack tonight. But you notice that so far we're contemplating what we're doing. We haven't jumped knee-jerk, taken out our gun, so to speak, and fired from the hip. We understand the difficulties, we understand the considerations, but we also understand this. We are a sovereign country. We have an obligation to defend our citizens against this savagery, and we will exercise that right when and as we see fit.
Israel's reputation down the years has not been one of reticence when it comes to battle. It often boasts that preemption in 1967 was the key to winning the war in 6 days. But 24 years on, the Middle East has changed. Israel's great ally, America, is siding with an Arab alliance against Iraq, and fear of splitting that alliance and being seen to be hungry for war has to be a major factor in Israel's decision to hold back now. If Iraq attacks again, however, it will be a different ballgame, and then Israel's entry into this war would, according to sources here, be inevitable. Michael Macmillan, BBC News, in Jerusalem.
President Bush has said he very much appreciates Israel's restraint so far in not retaliating against last night's attack from Scud missiles. He said the attack was an outrageous act of terror, clearly designed to weaken the Allied coalition against Iraq. The president said he was convinced the coalition would remain firm.
Mr. Bush traveled to the Pentagon to hear the latest reports from the war room and to thank Defense Department workers. But throughout the day, he has been more concerned by the political implications of Iraq's missile attacks than the military ones, repeatedly talking to Israeli leaders and trying to keep them out of the war.
We ought to guard against anything that can change the course of the war. And so I think everybody realizes what Saddam Hussein was trying to do, to change the course of the war, to weaken the coalition, and he's going to fail.
In fact, Mr. Bush had been telephoning Prime Minister Shamir while air raid sirens sounded in Israel. He commended the initial restraint, though would not be drawn on whether the Israelis might retaliate.
Israel is not a participant. Israel is not a combatant. And this man is elected to launch a terroristic attack against the population centers in Israel with no military design whatsoever. And that's why, and it is an outrage, and the whole world knows it, and the whole world is, most of the countries in the world are speaking out against it.
Hitting the remaining Scud missiles is the Pentagon's top priority, and commanders believe good intelligence and high technology is on their side given time. But the president knows casualties, perhaps heavy ones, in a ground war are unavoidable, and his warning was a cold shower on public opinion.
No one should doubt or question the ultimate success. Because we will prevail, but I don't want to see us get overly euphoric about all of this.
The possibility of Iraqi terrorism striking even in Washington has led to increased security at many foreign embassies. But some in Congress now believe the Allies' technological edge means Saddam Hussein's defeat in Operation Desert Storm cannot take long.
Desert storms are brief but violent. This one will rage and it will thunder. But by the time it is completed, much of Iraq's conventional military power will have been decimated and Iraq's weapons of mass destruction will be destroyed.
The president has decided to spend the weekend as usual at his Camp David retreat. This is not meant to signal overconfidence, rather that unlike President Carter, Mr. Bush will not become, during a Middle East crisis, the prisoner of the White House. Gavin Esler, BBC News, Washington.
In the House of Commons, the Foreign Secretary Douglas Hurd urged Israel to restrain itself. He said that would show strength, not weakness. For the opposition, Gerald Kaufman said Saddam Hussein had set a cynical trap for the Israelis, which they should not fall into by making a military response.
Downing Street knew the attack on Israel was the most serious development in the war so far. The Prime Minister, who hasn't had much sleep recently, had been in bed for only 45 minutes when he was awakened. His foreign policy adviser, Sir Charles Paul, made phone calls to Israel to urge restraint. By the time members of the War Cabinet assembled, fears of an immediate Israeli counterattack had gone. But when Douglas Hurd reported in the Commons, he repeated the warning he'd already given when the Israeli Foreign Minister came out of Cabinet to take his phone call.
I believe the House will want to join the Prime Minister and myself in condemning this outrageous attack on Israel's civilian population. It will be seen in all parts of the world as a reckless ploy to widen the conflict.
But London knows the UN Charter acknowledges that restraint can stretch just so far.
Israel has the right of self-defense, and no one can take this decision from them. But we believe that restraint by Israel at this time would be interpreted as strength, not weakness. Given the powerful military operation now underway against Iraq, in pursuit of the objectives laid down by the United Nations.
Labour joined in warning the Israelis about what one minister privately called the only strategy this man has.
Their restraint so far has been exemplary. Saddam Hussein has taken this action cynically to set a trap for the Israelis. And I hope the Israelis will not fall into that trap by making a military response. The cause of ending Saddam Hussein's aggression will more likely be damaged than enhanced by an Israeli military response.
But some MPs acknowledged a lot was being asked of the Israelis.
And recognizing that it is an anguished decision, does he not see that it is far easier to urge restraint from here than it is to accept it after you, your family, your friends, innocent civilians have been bombed, and when the restraint may be taken by Saddam Hussein as an indication of something else?
Whitehall hoped any retaliation would be limited and confined to military targets, but the Foreign Secretary was being studiously careful in what he said to a Tory MP.
Would my right honourable friend further agree that the restraint of which he spoke could take two forms, either no retaliation at all, or retaliation of a measured and limited and proportionate nature? Would it be his view that either form of retaliation would not be likely to break up the Arab coalition?
I have deliberately not been specific about the kind of restraint which the Israeli government might exercise.
What British ministers fear is that the Israeli response might be so heavy-handed that it would cause Arab members of the coalition to break ranks. But like President Bush, they understand the pressure on Jerusalem to hit back in some way.
Iraq has backed up its attack on Israel with a direct appeal on Baghdad radio tonight to all Arabs. The ruling Ba'ath Party urged Muslims round the world to attack Western interests. Saddam Hussein has repeatedly appealed to the Arab people over the heads of their governments. In Algiers, an estimated 400,000 people turned out to support Iraq.
Demonstrations spread across the Arab world like a rash inflamed by the Iraqi attack on Israel. The street activity measures the strength of public feeling against Israel and America. And it's stirring not just here in Algeria, but even in places like Morocco, which has committed ground troops to the UN alliance. it's an easy constituency for Saddam Hussein to appeal to.
We consider Israel to be the main factor of tension in our area. It is behind all the problems we have in our area.
The mosque is a power outside politics, and today in Jordan, the pulpits praised Iraq's actions. Arab governments, however autocratic, must be wary of the emotion that can be generated by hatred of Israel. And the easy equation, Israel's enemy is my friend.
We are happy about the attack from Iraq to Israel. Yeah, because we have our right to go back to our land.
Even those governments who are most firmly allied with America acknowledge the embarrassment of finding themselves, however indirectly, siding with Israel.
Any attempt on the part of Israel to inject itself in the picture will be indirectly serving the Iraqi regime's intention or attempt to make a linkage between their occupation of Kuwait and the problem of Palestine.
For King Hussein in Jordan, it's an immediate problem. Israel would use his airspace to strike against Iraq. The PLO would like him to try to stop them. A futile gesture, but one with incalculable consequences.
If you drag the Jordan to the battlefront, then you will be dragging all the Arab states, those who are with the coalition and those who are neutral.
The calculation in the West is that the Arab members of the coalition could withstand an Israeli retaliation, provided it was limited, avoided civilian casualties, and remained clearly separated from the actions of the UN alliance. But in the volatile politics of the Middle East, it's a judgment they'd rather not put to the test.
The Scud missile fired last night at one of the Allied air bases in Saudi Arabia was launched from the city of Basra in southern Iraq. But the missile was destroyed in one of the first successful interceptions of a Scud in flight. From Dhahran, Brian Barron reports.
At 4:30 this morning, Dhahran heard the sound everyone dreads, the alert for an incoming Iraqi Scud missile. As pilots at the airbase scrambled to get off the ground, civilians ran for shelter. In an atmosphere of fear and tension, the American army launched the only antidote to Scud, one of its own Patriot anti-missile missiles. It climbed to intercept the Scud and destroyed it. On slow motion, the final destructive explosion can be clearly seen. The Patriot looks more like a dumper lorry than a missile system, but today, on its first ever firing in wartime, its operators kept their heads as the Scud came towards them.
Always on edge. You don't have time to be. You don't have time to take a break. When you're talking a matter of seconds. It's life or death to thousands of people, to include ourselves. We've got to take a break.
There was not just one Allied response today, but a multitude of them, as the air power of Operation Desert Storm took the war deep inside Iraq. The precision of the cruise missile fired from the Gulf today makes Saddam's Soviet-designed Scud seem crude and inaccurate.
3, 2, 1, launch.
Missile away.
Yes, sir.
They've destroyed Saddam's palace in Baghdad. Allied fighter bombers have been staging hundreds of sorties today. American pilots returning from missions over Baghdad and Kuwait are still reporting an absence of coordinated Iraqi Air Force resistance.
It appears the kills that we've gotten up to this point have been, again, really not an organized air opposition. I think they're guys that basically got caught in the wrong place at the wrong time.
Marine Harriers are dropping cluster bombs on 30,000 Republican Guards, Saddam's elite troops.
These are good troops. You know, they're not going to scare that easily, but I think definitely if you look at a sustained around-the-clock bombing campaign against them, it's going to get to them. It's going to have a very much of a demoralizing effect.
Anything military that moves in Kuwait is a potential target. But not all goes to plan, despite the meticulous detailing of each operation.
it wasn't real successful because evidently the 4 to 5 positions must have moved during the night. They do that occasionally. So, well, we got up there and didn't find our original target because the prepared positions were empty. But we found a secondary target and dropped on it.
An absolute priority for the Allied Air Forces is finding Iraq's mobile Scud missiles. The somber reality is an unknown number are hidden away in occupied Kuwait. For everyone within Scud range, that's less than 300 miles, this is going to be a night of waiting. Dahran itself seems calm. Most people are in their homes because this is the Muslim Sabbath. They've almost lost count at the airbase of the number of air raid alerts. But at least places like this are protected by the Americans' Patriot anti-missile missile system. We've already had one alarm tonight. It was triggered by Dahran's early warning system, but was lifted after 30 minutes. Brian Barron, BBC News, Eastern Saudi Arabia.
The commander of the Allied forces, General Schwarzkopf, has stressed that destroying the Scud's mobile launchers is an airstrike priority. The Scud missiles are seen as the most potent weapon at the Iraqis' disposal because they may be capable of delivering chemical and biological weapons deep into neighboring territory. Our defense correspondent David Shukman assesses the Iraqi missile threat.
Of all the weaponry Saddam Hussein has acquired over the years, it's the 1,000 Scud missiles sold to him by Moscow that have always struck the greatest fear in his neighbors. Some 600 of the missiles were fired at Tehran in the War of the Cities 3 years ago. Their impact, though damaging and wounding, was mainly psychological, since each one only delivers the equivalent of a small bomb. Of Saddam's remaining 400 Scuds, exactly like these filmed in Afghanistan, he's used up an unknown number to develop longer range versions. And the estimate is that it takes 3 original Scuds to make 2 of the stretched versions. The result, possibly, is an Iraqi missile force now numbering 150. But the advantage of the extra range Saddam has achieved is obvious as he moves to involve Israel. The original Scuds only reach some 300 kilometers, the adapted Al-Hussein perhaps 450, while the Al-Abbas, the derivative with the longest range, was almost certainly the type aimed at Israel last night. The attack could, in theory, have been stopped because although Israel's own anti-missile system, shown here, isn't yet operational, America provided dozens of its Patriot missiles to Israel last month. They're designed to strike incoming missiles that have now proved they can. This footage of a test firing shows a Patriot rising under computer guidance to intercept a missile falling at 3,000 miles per hour. It did this for real last night. The Allied preference, of course, is to destroy Iraq's missiles before they're launched. And today in London, the Defense Secretary, who condemned the attack on Israel, said the hunt was on for Iraq's missiles to prevent it happening again.
I certainly hope that the success of the Allies and certainly the further successes today in the destruction of missile launchers, and particularly the mobile missile launchers, which are important to identify, will further diminish that risk. But we have, very clear, a very high priority for the destruction of the missile launchers, whether fixed or mobile, to prevent any repetition of that.
The launchers are most exposed once their missiles are fired because their heat gives them away to spy satellites equipped with infrared sensors. The coordinates of their locations can be passed to AWACS planes over Saudi Arabia, and they can direct bombers there, but by then all they can do is prevent further launches. America's Gulf commander, General Schwarzkopf, wants to achieve more than that, and in Riyadh this morning he gave his assessment.
Fortunately, the 7 missiles that were fired against Israel, I would characterize as having yielded absolutely insignificant results. And as a result, I think to date we can say that the enemy Scud campaign has been ineffective. Now for the good news. As you know, finding the fixed missile launchers is a relatively easy business, but finding the mobile launchers is like finding a needle in a haystack, as you can well imagine.
a sobering admission, since it's still unclear why the missiles fired last night were fitted with conventional, not chemical, warheads, as Saddam had threatened. Either Iraq simply can't, and the intelligence is wrong, or Saddam believed a chemical attack on Israel might produce a nuclear response.
The American Air Force has released the first pictures of the air raids on targets in Iraq and Kuwait. Filmed from the bombing aircraft, they show the extraordinary precision of the modern high-technology weapons that are being used in the Gulf War. The Americans say they mean civilian casualties can be minimized.
An American bomber's view of Baghdad. The Allies have released these remarkable pictures to prove the precision accuracy of their attacks. This one, for example, on the Iraqi Air Force HQ. At a briefing today, Lieutenant General Charles Horner, architect of the bombardment, talks reporters through the mission.
And this is my counterpart's headquarters in Baghdad. This is the headquarters of the Air Force. And keep your eye on all sides of the building as the airplane overflies the building and drops the bomb down through the center of the building.
On this occasion, the target is a Scud missile bunker in Kuwait. Like many others, it's about to be destroyed by laser-guided bombs, a technique first tried in Vietnam, but now developed to produce devastating accuracy. From 2 miles away, the F-111 directs its bombs into the door of the bunker.
And you'll be able to count each bomb. One, two.
Here, the eerily silent pilot's eye video shows an air defense headquarters reportedly used by Saddam Hussein. With the sights lined up, laser again guides down the bomb. This time, the way in is even more ingenious.
These are air shafts that provide best access into this concrete structure. And keep your eye on the front door, the airlock door, as the debris comes out the door from the bomb going in this lead-in air shaft.
Here, the target's already been hit once by a stealth bomber. The plane's so secret, the Americans didn't even admit they had it until 3 years ago. But the building still stands, so a second aircraft comes in to finish off the mission.
And this part of the building here provides some structural weakness that will be exploited in this attack, and the bomb will hit in this area here.
Airfields, too, are vital targets, of course, and this one is halfway between Baghdad and Kuwait. American pilots use the same combination of skill and laser technology to do the damage in the very center of the runway.
And now you'll see the pilot switch to higher magnification and as he flies away from the target. This is the smoke plume from the bomb, and there's the crater.
Lieutenant General Horner said such precision has always been a key requirement of Operation Desert Storm.
Certainly one of the strongest guidance we had from the very start is to avoid any damage to civilian targets and to the holy shrines that happen to be located in Iraq. And we've looked at every target from the outset for avenues of approach, the exact type of weapon to cause damage to the target but preclude damage in the surrounding area, and precision delivery.
The pictures the Americans have released here today are, of course, their selection, and not all their attacks will have been so accurate or so successful. But what they do appear to show is that the Allies want to use their technological advantage not only to win this war, but to win it with a minimum of civilian casualties. Ben Brown, BBC News, Riyadh in Saudi Arabia.
Baghdad radio claimed tonight that Iraqi forces shot down 22 Allied aircraft today, bringing the total number hit to 94. Although there's been no direct response to that from Washington, similar claims yesterday were dismissed as ridiculous by the Pentagon. The first pictures of Wednesday night's Allied air attack on Baghdad have now reached London. They were filmed by a BBC crew with our foreign affairs editor, John Simpson.
The sirens went off at 20 to 3, and even before that, the big machine guns on the tops of buildings around here were firing tracer into the sky. I was out with two colleagues in a car when the attack began. There was, of course, very little traffic on the roads at that point, and the tracer began springing up all round us. Our driver refused to take us any further and insisted on going back to the hotel, where we watched the battle from a fifth-story window. The
At the moment, we're waiting for the American bombers to come. All the firing that's going on, and there's a great deal of it, is just pretty wildly up in the air. It doesn't seem to be aimed at anything. It looks as though they're just getting ready for the big attack, preparing themselves, and just firing off at nothing.
What we didn't know at that stage was that the Allied planes were too high for us to hear, and certainly too high for the outdated technology which Iraq has to hit. And the missiles, as they went over, made surprisingly little noise. The hotel staff, the other guests, and many of the journalists were down in the big shelters 50 feet below ground. After an initial panic, things calmed down quickly. People first of all became used to the overcrowding and the strange and bewildering conditions, and then they started to try to keep their spirits up and even enjoy themselves in a strange sort of way. Armed guards made it very difficult for us to get out of the shelters and back into the main part of the hotel, but in the end we managed it. At first light, the city looked virtually unchanged. The fears about carpet bombing and indiscriminate attacks on residential areas turned out to be unfounded. The bombs and the missiles seem mostly to have landed with pinpoint accuracy. The telecommunications center, which we couldn't film, was plugged neatly by at least two rockets. There was a cloud of smoke over the defense ministry, which had been completely taken out, presumably by missiles. We headed out again through the deserted streets. For the most part, only soldiers, whom, again, we couldn't get shots of, were around, leaderless and bewildered. We were quickly spotted and stopped by a security policeman in an unmarked car, but we managed to trick him into coming back to our hotel where we gave him the slip.
This is a very strange war indeed. The only reminder you have that it's going on is the rumble of high explosive and the racket of the completely ineffective anti-aircraft fire from the ground. The technology which the Allied side has at its disposal has never been used before in anger. A few minutes ago, a missile, perhaps a Tomahawk or some other type of cruise missile, passed along the line of this road here at 100 feet high. What its target was, we don't know. John Simpson, BBC News, Baghdad.
Well, we've just established a satellite link with our Middle East correspondent, Michael Macmillan, who you will remember reported earlier that the Israeli cabinet was divided over whether to retaliate for the Scud attacks on Israel. Michael, how serious is the split?
I think it's a split, obviously. I mean, it's difficult to say how serious it is, but it's serious enough to prevent the Israelis launching into an immediate attack upon Iraq. The Israeli cabinet met this morning. Prime Minister Shamir, throughout the past week, has made it clear that Israel reserves the right to defend itself. He has not said that Israel will automatically launch against Iraq if it's attacked with missiles. Much will depend on what happens tonight. There is, of course, an air of tension here. We had an air raid siren go off 2 hours ago. 25 minutes later, the all clear was sounded. But I think the Israelis are very wary that what happened last night could happen again. And we have received no information to indicate that those mobile Scud missile launches in western Iraq have been destroyed.
You talk about the air raid sirens going off tonight. Is it likely that if there is another Scud missile attack, the arguments of the hawks in the cabinet will be difficult to resist?
I would have thought that if more missiles are launched against Israel, and they do considerable damage if they kill people, then certainly it will be difficult to resist the temptation of launching against Iraq and retaliating. I think the mood within the Israeli government is to be seen not to be warmongering, not to be hungry for war, but to wait to see, to respect the fact that there is an Arab alliance, and if Israel entered this war, there would be a great danger of splitting that Arab alliance. Israel also wants to certainly take into consideration the American side of things. President Bush spoke to Mr. Shamir this morning, and he assured him that he would do everything he possibly could to destroy those mobile launchers.
But it is, of course, a very difficult decision for Israel to take because, as I understand it, there is no precedent in Israeli history for not retaliating to a military strike.
There certainly is no precedent, and it's not certainly in the Israeli psyche to do what they've done today. But as I said, they don't want to split the Arab alliance immediately. They want to give the Americans a chance to do their work. And President Bush has assured Mr. Shamir that the Americans will do everything they possibly can do to prevent a repeat of what happened last night.
Israel, of course, prides herself on her military defences. Is it considered something of a military failure that the Scuds got through last night?
It's not considered a military failure here. The Israelis say that no amount of equipment would have detected those Scud missiles. However, I think certainly as far as the public are concerned, they're quite aware that there probably will be no warning, and that 1 minute you can be standing here and the next minute there will be an explosion and the Scud missile will have landed. So clearly there is nothing that they can do to detect these missiles early.
You say no amount of equipment would have detected them, and yet an American Patriot missile shot down a Scud above Dharan Air Base yesterday.
Well, the Israelis do not have that equipment, although we've heard that they have received advanced Patriot missiles within the past week from the Americans. It's clear that those missiles are not in operation and weren't in operation and weren't able to deflect those Scud missiles which came in last night. So it's quite apparent that the Israelis are not in the position to be able to detect an attack like the one that happened last night, before it happens.
Michael Macmillan in Jerusalem, thank you very much indeed. Well, now we go back to the impact of the Allied attacks on Iraq. John Simpson, whose report you saw earlier, has been phoning into the BBC during the day to report by satellite telephone from Baghdad. Twice he was cut off, and like other journalists in the Iraqi capital, he is now subject to strict censorship. He rang in his first report shortly before 11 a.m.
The system, which seemed so shattered yesterday and bewildered by what had happened, seems to be trying to reassert itself a little, particularly in our case. It's now becoming clear that we're going to be very heavily censored in a matter of an hour or so's time. I'm having to make this broadcast illegally by lurking around in the shadows and just trying to make use of a little bit of cover here that's provided by a hedge, because they're looking for us, they're trying to stop us doing this. As for the setup in the city as a whole, from what we can see, there were more attacks last night and early this morning. The presidential palace was hit. It's reported, I haven't spoken to him myself, but others say they have spoken to the Soviet ambassador, who saw President Saddam Hussein in the bunker underneath the palace, and he still seems to be alive and well. Otherwise, there's been quite a lot of other damage in the night. We've had one air raid so far today, but none recently. We've been interrupted by the security police, and they're trying to stop us broadcasting now. There is, in fact, a security policeman standing just about 10 yards away from me, and I'm just pretending that I'm kind of fiddling with the machine. We get no information, whatever. There's no means, there's no channel for information, because the people who deal with us are simply leaderless and without any kind of instruction themselves. So therefore, the only information we get is that which we can get from talking to people, from watching things, and from straying out when we can. But even that is difficult. I tried to get out of the hotel last night because, in fact, I should tell you this, we have word from Washington that our hotel, or at least the area around it, was going to be hit last night. I just felt it was probably going to be more difficult to work inside the hotel than out, and we were going to go into the hotel grounds and film from there. In fact, there was quite a great deal of bombing all the way around. You could feel the building vibrating in the shelter underground where we spent the night. Our satellite telephone system here was completely swamped by the signals being sent out, we think, by AWACS aircraft guiding in the latest raid from B-52 bombers, which came over in the last hour and did an extraordinary amount of damage in the outskirts of Baghdad. We have a Ministry of Information minder sitting with me at the moment as I speak, but he's an extremely friendly and tolerant person, and I don't think he'll object to too much that I'm saying at the moment. A great power station on the outskirts of the city was blown up with fantastic, spectacular results. And also the telecommunications tower, where the dishes had been hanging off already, that went up in a shower of flame and sparks and made quite a show.
The Prime Minister, John Major, has telephoned the commander of British forces in the Gulf tonight to congratulate him on the performance of the forces stationed in the region. The Prime Minister discussed all aspects of the Allied campaign against Iraq with Sir Peter de la Billière, including the intensive bombing sorties undertaken by British Tornadoes. It's now known that three Tornadoes are missing in action, two RAF planes and one flown by the Italian Air Force.
another sortie for British Tornado bombers based in eastern Saudi Arabia. British and Saudi squadrons operate the same aircraft from here, and war is forging close bonds between them. RAF ground crews work through the night to rearm Tornadoes. Not far away, ex-RAF men who, in peacetime, took lucrative contracts to come and work for the Saudi Air Force.
If somebody had asked me this time last year, or even 6 months ago, what I would have been doing fighting a war for another nation, I'd have just laughed in the face. But as you can see, things are a lot different now.
While Saudi crewmates answer the call to prayer in a makeshift mosque beside the aircraft shelter, the contract airmen work on. Aircraft from this squadron joined in the first attacks on Iraq, flying in formation with RAF bombers. The loss of a British aircraft that night was felt by Saudi pilots too.
You know, the reaction was, really, we feel sorry for each other, really, in the air, because I feel what he feel. And you know, he's a friend, and he came here to help me and support me. And I was really sorry, and all of our friends, because when we lose a friend, we lose a friend.
In a few hours, this aircraft will leave on its next raid. The mission will provide one more lesson in how the fates of British and Saudi Tornado crews have become interwoven.
Chili or steak?
The British crews eating close to their aircraft, the losses have been a blow too.
It's like you're devastated because you think they went out to do a job and they've done the job. If they don't make it back, then it's hard to describe. You feel sorry, but the job's been done.
Mark Urban, BBC News, at an airbase in eastern Saudi Arabia.
And on the ground in Saudi Arabia, Allied forces have been continuing their move northwards into their battle positions. For some British forces, the redeployment puts them within striking distance of Iraqi positions in Kuwait.
For British troops, another morning of poison gas alert, the third in 3 days. These men were climbing out of their chemical protective equipment just in time for the transfer to another part of the desert. Transport by Royal Navy Seeking helicopters and Royal Air Force Chinooks. A heavy lift operation for a massive deployment out of the training areas to a desert location where Britain's 1st Armored Division will be within striking distance of Iraqi positions in Kuwait. The deployment is accelerating while the air war continues. Heavy equipment is also traveling in the same direction. There are thousands of men preparing to move or on the move from one part of the desert to another, from a training to an operational role. When and whether they'll be in combat depends on the results of the air war. This is Martin Bell with the leading battle group for the British Television News Pool.
Well, British forces have carried out practice drills for months using gas masks and special suits. Our chief news correspondent, Kate Adie, sent us this report.
With an Iraqi Scud missile intercepted overhead, British troops in the Saudi desert were alerted to an increased threat of chemical warfare. And today, added to the respirators and the protective clothing precautions, nerve agent pre-treatment tablets.
You need to have your second set of nap tablets. Right.
This is the first time that British soldiers have been instructed to take these by their military commanders.
They have been taken in test conditions. They have been tried and proven. However, as I say, it is the first time they've been taken on a mass basis in the field.
You've had a couple now. Are you all right?
Yeah, fine. No problems at all.
The mere threat of a so-called dirty war with chemical, biological or nerve agents being used is calculated as an effective weapon in itself. It is countered by good training and equipment and a large supply of squaddie's good humour.
Okay, yeah, we'll have some of that.
Loads of crisps.
So this morning, a group of gunners from Manchester concentrated on the better things in desert life, parcels from home.
Oh, this is my second parcel. I got one off my sister and this is off my wife from Germany. And it's great relief, you know, hunger on the gun and all that, see. So, morale boosting and all that.
Number 5 Gun Detachment, O Battery 2nd Field Regiment. Mancunians all, with the odd stray Liverpudlian, mates at home and very much reliant on each other in the close world inside a Royal Artillery M109 gun. It's a family engaged on serious business.
The men that we've got here are basically youngsters. We've got a lot of young men here. However, they're all keen, willing to learn, and actually now want to get up north and do the job that we've sent out here to do.
You say youngsters. I mean, is that an advantage?
It is for me. They do all the running for us.
Sergeant Sharp makes a good mother.
So the gun detachment family learns to dig in to protect themselves in the sand and wait to take on the Iraqis.
Now, to take stock of the second day of the Allies' military campaign, here's our defence correspondent, David Shukman. David, why can't the Allied commanders be more specific about how well we are doing about the against the Scud launchers and other selected targets?
Well, I think despite the release of the very striking pictures from the Pentagon, Pentagon sources in Riyadh this morning, showing the precision bombing that went on, most aircraft deployed against Iraq don't carry those kind of cameras, so special reconnaissance missions have to be launched to try and seek out all the different bomb damage assessment targets to work out exactly what has happened and where indeed the Scuds are. Now, to do that requires pretty good clear weather conditions, and I understand that cloud conditions over Iraq have hampered a number of those flights.
And are the Allies able to change military policy so that they can concentrate on looking for those mobile Scud launchers?
Well, the single integrated operating plan that's been devised over the last few months, I understand, does have a fair degree of flexibility in it. The Scuds, anyway, were a primary target. The Allied commanders always realised there would be a risk of those being launched off in the very first early hours of an Allied onslaught. So I think although Allied commanders are emphasising the importance they're now attaching to the Scud launchers, particularly with the involvement now of Israel, they always have attached great priority to the Scud, so I don't think there's been a great shift of strategy now.
We hear tonight that American F-15s are operating out of bases in Turkey. Is that of great military significance?
I don't think it is really. Those aircraft and others from the American Air Force have been stationed in Turkey for some time now and have been waiting political approval from the Turkish government before becoming involved. Most of the American air assets are deployed in four other countries near Iraq and on six giant carriers in the Red Sea and in the Gulf itself. So really the extra planes that can now be used from Turkey I don't think will add much in terms of military weight.
What do the Allied air forces need to achieve before the command can be given for the ground forces to move in?
Well, in short, they need still to achieve air supremacy. One defence source I spoke to this afternoon said that it really is day two only. Don't expect too much too fast. Things are, I think, going pretty well as planned, but there's a great deal more to do. Evidence of the fact that the Iraqi Air Force is still to be immobilised is the fact that this afternoon we were told Tornado F-3 fighter interceptors from the Royal Air Force in Saudi Arabia had to be scrambled to try and head off some Iraqi Air Force planes that were threatening American planes over Kuwait. The very fact that those Iraqi planes were airborne indicates to intelligence officials that not all Iraqi air bases have been destroyed. Air supremacy has not been achieved yet. There's still a lot more bombing to be done on that front.
David Shukman, thanks very much indeed. The government has taken further measures to tighten security here. Tonight, seven Palestinians were detained by police and immigration officers and will be deported. The Home Office said they posed a threat to national security. The Home Office has also said that no new visas will be issued to Iraqi nationals.
This is the visible response to the internal threat to Britain. The army joining security operations today at another airport, Gatwick. But the real work has been going on in secret for months by the intelligence services. It was their assessments which led to the detention and deportation orders against Palestinians, in addition to the 130 Iraqis similarly dealt with since the start of the Gulf crisis. Britain has now all but closed borders to Iraqis. No new visas will be issued to them. Existing short-term permits won't be renewed, and transit rights at airports have been removed from Iraqi nationals. But while controls on them tighten, the government is trying to reassure the British Muslim community in general, in the wake of an arson attack on a mosque in Yorkshire. The Home Secretary said differing views on what was happening in the Gulf, even support for Saddam Hussein, shouldn't be seen as calling into question the loyalty of Muslims to their adopted country.
We are not engaged in a holy war in the Middle East. What we are engaged in is an exercise to ensure that a Muslim country, Kuwait, is freed from an aggressor. And alongside British troops in the Middle East, they will be fighting many Muslims from Kuwait, from Saudi Arabia, from Egypt.
Some prominent British Muslims have had a meeting with the Foreign Office Minister, Douglas Hogg. It produced a full exchange of views, according to the Foreign Office, but a spokesman declined to reveal what Mr. Hogg said to them.
Today's news from the Gulf did not cause the same wild fluctuations in the financial markets as yesterday. The price of oil slid again, falling by more than $2 to $18.80 a barrel. The 100-share index closed just 1.9 points down after recovering earlier losses. And now today's other news. The annual rate of inflation fell last month to 9.3%. That's down on the previous month's figure of 9.7%. The fall was partly due to lower petrol prices.
The sharp falls in inflation, which Chancellor Norman Lamont hopes will bring it down to around 5% by the end of the year, are now beginning to come through. December's rate of 9.3% is well down on the peak of nearly 11% in October and the lowest level since last March. Last month's fall was mainly due to lower petrol prices. Prices fell 12 pence a gallon in December. Heating oil and other fuel costs also fell back. Although petrol has crept up again in recent days, the longer-term threat of sharply higher world oil prices seems to have passed. On the commodity markets, oil was stable today. And if that continues, petrol prices could come down again early next week. What's clear in Britain's high streets is that other prices are already coming down. Special offers and discounts are widespread as businesses struggle to attract customers. Last month's figures show no increase in the price of clothes and many household goods, while car prices fell. That's a sure sign it's the recession which is starting to drive inflation down.
Three British railway workers were killed today in an accident involving an empty passenger train. It happened at Edge Hill in Liverpool as they were repairing a set of faulty points. British Rail described the accident as regrettable and tragic and has ordered an inquiry. An Irishman serving a 25-year jail sentence for plotting to cause explosions has been refused leave by the Court of Appeal to challenge his conviction. Gilbert McNamee, who's 30, was linked by fingerprint evidence to the Hyde Park bombing in 1982, in which four soldiers were killed. The appeal court rejected claims that his trial had been unfair. Well, we're going back to the Gulf War now. Within the last half hour, the Pentagon has been giving a briefing to reporters in Washington. Mike Smart has been there and he has the details. Mike, what have they been saying?
Well, the briefing was given, in fact, by Lieutenant General Tom Kelly, and the latest news is that the US forces have lost another plane. It's an intruder fighter, that's a Navy plane. It's the same as another one of the planes have been lost. Four planes have been lost now altogether. Lieutenant General Kelly said that nine crewmen were missing. He then corrected that and said that only seven crewmen were missing. One of those is thought to be dead. Search and rescue operations are being carried out for the others. He was also asked about the reports from the fighting zone that some US servicemen have been taken prisoner. Lieutenant General Kelly said they had no reports of that, but they couldn't discount it.
Yes, and Michael, is there any further word from the United States about is the Israeli cabinet's reaction to the Scud missile attacks yesterday, the divisions within the Israeli cabinet?
Well, I'm sorry, I'm not able to talk about that, really, because I've been doing the briefing, and in fact, there wasn't really much talk of that. I can tell you that Lieutenant General Kelly did say that they were continuing to look for the mobile Scud missile sites. He said that he didn't say whether they'd found or destroyed them, but he said the operations were going very well. So that suggests that things are going well.
Mike Smart in Washington, thank you very much indeed. And so to tonight's main news again. The Israeli cabinet appears divided on whether to retaliate for last night's Scud missile attack by Iraq. President Bush has described the attack as an act of terror and praised Israel for the restraint it has shown so far. Allied aircraft have again bombed Baghdad. The presidential palace and the telecommunications center have been badly damaged. The Americans say the Allies are flying 2,000 sorties a day and that 80% of them are successful. A second British tornado has been lost and as you've just heard, another American plane has been lost. Newsnight is on BBC Two at 10:30, and there'll be further news summaries tonight here on BBC One at 9:50 and at 1:30. Tomorrow morning, Breakfast News will be on the air with a 10-minute news bulletin at 7:00 and an hour-long programme starting at 8:00. And of course, we will bring you any further major developments on this channel as they happen. That's the 9:00 news. Good night.